Well, thank you all very much for coming at the end of this long day and long week. My name is Tom Friedman. I'm a foreign affairs columnist for the New York Times, and I'm here with my friend, colleague, director, and producer, Sally Granatstein. And what we're going to talk to you about today is a new TV show that we've been working on. It's called Years of Living Dangerously. It's what it's called. It's what we've been doing. It's going to be on Showtime starting next year. It's an 8-part series, and Sally's going to tell you about the details. And I've been involved in one of them, and it's about climate change and the Arab Spring, and how climate and environmental factors really were critical stressors that did not cause the Arab Spring, but certainly facilitated it. And so to begin with, I'm going to interview Saul a little bit on the background of the documentary and how this all came about. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about what we found in our travels. We've just come from Yemen, Turkey, Syria, and Egypt 10 days ago, I think. And then we're going to show you 4 clips, 2 from our part of the series, from Yemen and Syria, and then 1 from Chile from another part of the series, and 1 from...
One from Long Island.
Long Island, okay, the Sandy, post-Sandy.
Staten Island.
Staten Island, okay. Yeah. So if you could just begin and share with people, you're a former 60 Minutes producer. Yeah. David Gelbar and Joel Bach, the other two senior producers, are former 60 Minutes producers. How in the world did you guys give up jobs at the top of the TV pyramid working for 60 Minutes to do this?
Well, thanks a lot, Tom. It's been great working with Tom Friedman and going to all these countries where, I think I'd been traveling a lot as a producer for 60 Minutes all over the world. And, 60 Minutes, those two words really open doors pretty much everywhere you go. I think actually Thomas Friedman in the New York Times opened up even more doors than 60 Minutes did. So David Gelber, Joel Bach, and I, we're all colleagues together at 60 Minutes for many years. We had all been on Scott Pelley's team producing for him, and we had done climate change stories here and there over the years that we were working for that program. And what we found was, you really can get away with only about 1 climate change story per year at 60, because 60 is, covers the whole world. And I think that especially in recent years, I'm sure everybody here has noticed that, climate change has become this politically contentious issue, whereas, up till a few years ago, it was something that everyone agreed was happening and was serious and needed to be addressed and needed to be reported on. So I think that the opening for stories on climate change became less and less. And so the three of us really agreed that we'd like to do something, particularly on climate change. We felt that it was the biggest story of our time, the most important, serious thing facing the planet, facing the human race. And so we decided, we basically got together with a series of real Hollywood bigwigs, starting with Jerry Weintraub, the huge Hollywood producer, who put us in touch with James Cameron, and then Arnold Schwarzenegger. And so those three are actually executive producers of Years of Living Dangerously, and then the three of us, former 60 Minutes guys, are the ones who are kind of running the show on a day-to-day basis. So that's how it all started.
How did you raise the money for this?
We have a contract with Showtime. We're basically delivering this to Showtime.
When will it appear?
It's appearing around February of next year. So, I don't know, not that long from now. We're working very hard on it. These days, if you want to basically produce a series and bring a pilot, especially something like climate change, which doesn't necessarily sell itself, you actually have to raise the funds yourself. So we have a little bit of money from Showtime for production, but mostly we're supported by philanthropic donations from people like George Soros, Jeremy Grantham, Chris Hahn, Amos Hostetter. Ford Foundation's giving us some money. So we've been able to raise actually quite a bit of money to make it all possible. We still need a little bit more. So anybody who wants to get involved, feel free to approach me afterwards and I'll tell you how you can.
So tell me about, it's going to be 6 to 8 shows. And what are the subject areas besides our own?
So, so we're, you know, we're working on climate change and the Arab Spring, other stories, and each, we have basically about 18 different stories that are going to be interwoven Game of Thrones style, you know, throughout the series. So it won't be like we have one story, then the next story, then the next story. It'll be, we start one story for 5 minutes, just when you can't wait to find out what happens next, we'll jump to the next story and do the same thing. And then stories will continue from one week to another. And the idea is that they're really character-driven narratives.
And who are some of the other people besides
Mike? So Arnold Schwarzenegger is the correspondent for a story about wildfires and in the West. And, you know, of course, we're all aware of this the tragedy from last night, the 19 firefighters who were killed. That will definitely be part of the story now. Mm-hmm. Don Cheadle is doing a story about the Southwest drought, focused mostly in Plainview, Texas. Harrison Ford, we're about to go off to Indonesia to do a story about deforestation and climate change. Leslie Stahl from 60 Minutes is doing a story about the melting of the Arctic. Mark Bittman, your colleague from The Times, is doing a story about Superstorm Sandy in New Jersey. Olivia Munn is doing a story about Governor Jay Inslee, a profile of him, sort of the climate governor from Washington State. Matt Damon is going to be one of our correspondents. We're still working on exactly which story he's going to do. Michael Hall from Dexter from Showtime is going to be doing a story about climate change in Bangladesh. And that's and there's some others, but those are the big ones, basically.
Terrific. Well, let me just take a few minutes to share with you what we learned on our trip and how we sort of approached this issue. And then we're going to show you the clips and then open it up for questions. So our first trip was to Yemen. We arrived on an evening in the wake of a flash rainstorm, which had become much more violent and common in Yemen these days. We arrived in Sana'a, and Sana'a has a, the old city of Sana'a, which is a UN heritage site, has a winding road that basically bisects the old city, which is one of the most remarkable places in the world. It's called the Sila. For many years, it was just mud and dirt and pepper trees. And in 1995, the US government, at the request of the Yemeni government, agreed to pave the Sila. Now, when it was just dirt and pepper trees, it naturally absorbed all of the water. But one of the things that's happened in Yemen over the last two decades is massive deforestation. So now it rains, all the water rushes down from the mountains, ends up in the lowest spot in Sana'a, which is the Sila. So as we drove to our hotel in the old city, I'd say we were driving through 2 or 3 feet of water, basically a rushing river. We literally gave new meaning to the term, we sailed into town. And that was our introduction. So the main story we did in Yemen, I will say as an aside, this trip for me was a unique trip. I did something on this trip I have never done before. In all my time reporting from the Middle East and the Arab world, I spent the entire time exclusively talking to Arab environmentalists. I don't think we talked to one politician. We didn't meet one official. And they are an amazing community. You know, very anonymous, few people, you know this group of people, but they are an amazing group of people. And I've had a chance to, you know, experience other such communities around the world, and they are second to none. So our host, and we have sort of characters that we go through these shows with. Our host, as you'll see in the documentary from a clip here from Yemen, is a man named Abdurrahman al-Iryani. Who was Yemen's Minister of Environment and Water for many years. He's now out of the government, but an advisor to the new government. And he is the one who, you'll see in the film, is taking us around. Now, the story we did in Yemen was we hired a Yemeni Air Force helicopter. You can do that.
You can do that.
Yeah, that's right.
Not everybody can do
that. One can do that. And for a few extra dollars, they'll fly with the doors open so Sally can film. And for a few extra dollars, they would take us wherever we wanted. Now, Yemen is just a remarkable countryside, as you will see. And we flew to the Central Highlands, to the third largest city in Yemen, a town called Taiz. where two villages outside of town have been in a 10-year war over a water well. Basically, 80% of the conflicts in Yemen today are water-related. 10 years ago, well, I've got this number right, in the 1980s, 30 years ago, if you were drilling a well for water in Yemen, you had to go down about 60 meters. You now need to go 800 to 1,000 meters. That's what's happened to the water table. So we flew to Taiz, and Taiz is the third largest city where they turn on the water 36 hours every 40 days. So you need to fill your bathtub, fill every pan that you can, and otherwise you have to buy water from a water tanker. And as you'll see, we go there with Abdurrahman, and we film the aftermath of the battle between these two villages. We meet with the elders of the two villages. It'll go by a little quickly, but one thing you'll notice, I ask each of them how many kids they have, and they each have 10. And our main character in Syria, which you're not going to see this part of the film, had 16. So the three leading characters of our film have 36 children between them, which, of course, is a big part of the problem. One of the most fun things we did in Yemen with Abdurrahman is track or study the fate of the Arabian leopard. Yeah, it's always the most revealing thing is to study what's happening to the apex predator in any environment. Because once you know what's happening to the apex predator, you have a pretty good idea what's happening to the people. And the apex predator at the top of the food chain in Yemen is the Arabian leopard. And of course, it's going extinct right alongside of the people. The reason it's going extinct is because it feeds on rabbit and antelope and ibex, and the rabbit and antelope and ibex are disappearing because basically Yemen in the 70s, 3 million men from Yemen basically went to Saudi Arabia and the Gulf to build the Gulf. They vacated the country. And during that period, the terracing on the hillsides, it was just too much for the women left behind, so a lot of that got degraded. There was massive deforestation, so there was a huge silting of the wadis. You remember Yemeni coffee. Yemen was famous for coffee for centuries. Yemeni coffee was grown in the wadis. The wadis got silted. It wiped out the coffee industry. People turned to the next best cash crop, which was khat, this leafy, narcotic-like leaf that people used to literally chew and get high every day. And khat is hugely water-intensive. Takes 40% of the water in any environment. So that's the kind of spiral that Yemen is in today. But we went to the Sana Zoo. Who knew there was a Sana Zoo? And interviewed a man named David Stanton, who's an American English teacher in Yemen, who created the Arabian Leopard Preservation Society. And Sal set it all up. We sort of filmed right outside the cage with this leopard prowling back and forth. But there's one quote from Stanton I really liked. He said, Stanton started his work before the democracy revolution here in 2011, and back then he recalled people would come to me and say, why are you protecting the leopards? Why are you protecting these predators when we have leopards in our government? These governments really were like huge predatory animals. And what's happened now is everything they fed on is basically disappearing. So that was the Yemen story. Syria, which was our next stop, the Syria story is very simple. Syria, between 2006 and 2011, experienced the worst drought in its modern recorded history. Roughly 800,000 people left the countryside, herders and farmers, in the Jazeera region between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers and moved into cities between 2006 and 2011. This was a mass migration of people that the government was not only ill-prepared to handle, but did nothing for these people. And that's why it is no accident that the Syrian uprising began in the two driest spots in the country, Dara and Qamishli. And what you'll see in our documentary is we interviewed a Syrian climate refugee, a woman named Fatin, whose family were farmers, and had to leave their land because of the drought. They moved into the cities. Assad did nothing for them. And basically, he turned 1 million farmers and herders, basically conservative people, into revolutionaries. So when the revolution started, for other reasons in other places, they could not wait to join. There is no Syrian uprising at the scale we've seen without the drought. And we don't have this in this little clip, but we also interviewed the Free Syrian Army commander in the north, who had 16 kids, who was a cotton farmer. His farm was wiped out, he went into smuggling, and now he's the Free Syrian Army commander. The Arabic word for drought is jafaf, and you'll hear that word a lot in this movie. So without the drought, you never would have had, I think, this kind of revolution as widespread as you had in Syria. Our last stop was, very quickly, was Egypt. And in Egypt, our main focus were, we focused on two places. First was the Red Sea, because the Red Sea is one has 800 species of coral, 1,200 species of fish. It is the richest marine ecosystem outside of Indonesia. And for those of you who maybe have snorkeled or dived in Indonesia, the Red Sea is really a second only to Indonesia. We went down to the Red Sea and were hosted by two amazing Egyptian environmentalists, Amr Ali and Ahmed Droubi. Ahmed Droubi's head of Greenpeace of Egypt, and Amr Ali, the head of the Hergada Environmental Protection and Conservation Association, it's called HEPCA. And the two of them were partners in this project. And we actually dove with them to basically look at what had happened to the coral in the Red Sea and the whole marine ecosystem. So the short story is that in 1997, there was actually a global coral bleaching event that the Red Sea, for whatever reason, escaped. But last year, 2010, they had a huge bleaching incident. 2012, had a huge bleaching incident in the Red Sea when the temperature of the Red Sea rose by about 2 degrees centigrade. Now, for those of you who have been down to the Red Sea area, it is unfortunately a monument to irresponsible and reckless development with no government control. It is one massive hotel after another where people literally crush the coral to expand their hotels into the ocean. And that's what led to the rise of this environmental organization to try to save both the coral and the marine ecosystem, which is all woven together. So basically, a lot of people come to the Red Sea to swim with sharks, to dive with sharks. And they come from all over the world to do that. So what's going on there, people, fishermen were killing all the sharks, selling their fins to China for shark fin soup, and then the carcass for meat. As a result of that, what happened was, because the shark is the apex predator in the Red Sea, the medium predators started to proliferate. Because as the sharks disappeared, you had this huge explosion of medium predators who fed on the herbivores. And the herbivores are critical, basically, for maintaining the whole coral system. They basically eat the algae and clear out the substrate for coral to colonize. And so the whole system was unraveling. And then when they got a temperature rise, because the system was less resilient, they had this bleaching incident. So we went diving. We had an underwater cameraman from Italy. And we basically show the bleaching and show the live coral. The heroes of this story are Amr Ali and Droubi, who basically went to the local government. The national government in Cairo was uninterested. All they were interested in was selling land to developers. And so, but the local government was interested in the tourism. The fishermen were interested in the fishing. And the local government also wanted the taxes from tourism. So what they explained to the fishermen and the local government is that every shark they kill is worth about $150 in shark fin soup and shark meat. But every live shark, which sharks live for about 30 years, is worth $150,000 in airfare, hotels, tourism, and dive tours. Once they explained that to them, the light bulb went out. They said, we're not going to tell you about climate. We're not going to even mention the word climate. They just did the simple math for them. And they developed a whole ecosystem to reverse this process and save the Red Sea. And that's really what our documentary there is about. We then went to Cairo, and we did the bread story. And I'll conclude with this very, very simply. In 2010, late 2010 and early 2011, there was a huge global wheat crisis. Because of the coincidence of wildfires in Russia, floods in China, and drought in Australia. Or maybe it was drought in China and floods in Australia. I always mix that up. China, Russia, and Australia are world's three of the biggest wheat exporters. The wheat market is very tight globally. You get about a 6 to 18% surplus of wheat in any given year that is globally traded. 9 of the 10 world's biggest wheat importers are in the Middle East. Okay, and so what happened in 2010, 2011, and just to remind you, the Tunisian uprising happens in December 2010 and Cairo in January 2011, January, February, is that there was a huge spike in wheat prices. Wheat went from $157 a metric ton in June 2010 to $326 a metric ton in February 2011, which is when the Egyptian uprising happened. Now, bread in Egypt is called aish in Arabic, which means life, because people, it is literally the difference between life and death. Bread in Egypt is government controlled at government bakeries. It can only be, it has to be sold for 5 piastres a loaf, for 1 pita loaf, which is, you know, pennies of pennies. We went to a bakery in Imbaba, a very poor neighborhood in Cairo, an official government bakery, where we basically watched as the people lined up very early in the morning for 5 piastre bread, which runs out very quickly because the baker, in order to survive, sells his government-provided subsidized wheat to private bakeries for 10 times the price. So it happened back in the time of the Egyptian Revolution. People lined up at 4:30 in the morning for bread, and there was 5 piastre bread. It ran out by 6 in the morning, and then if you wanted bread, if you wanted aish, you had to go buy it at a private bakery for 35 piastres, 7 times the price. Hence, the reason that the Egyptian Revolution motto was bread, dignity, freedom. So this whole global bread story takes you back to something John Muir, the founder of the Sierra Club, used to say, which is famously said, everything in the universe is hitched. You know, wildfires in Russia, floods in China, or floods in Australia, drought in China, and it's all suddenly ends up in a bakery in Cairo. And that is the story that we tell. I just conclude by saying, you know, the thing I learned most, you know, from this trip is that there's no Arab leaders who really thought about environmentalism or their natural capital for all these years. There will be no Arab leader in the future who doesn't think about environmentalism and natural capital in the future. They will not be able to because all of these pressures are coming in. And the beauty of hanging around with these amazing Arab environmentalists is that all they think about is the commons. They're not thinking Sunni, Shiite, Christian, you know, Kurdish water or wheat. All they think about is the commons. And, you know, you'll hear often in the Arab world, people say we tried everything and nothing worked. We tried Nasserism, socialism, communism, Islamism, democracyism, nothing worked. But in fact, there's one ism they haven't tried, and it's going to be the ism of the future, environmentalism. Because without an environmental ethic that is placing the commons at the center, they will not have sustainable economies or sustainable democracies, and everything will simply be musical chairs. On to the film.
Saul, you want to just... That's okay.
Where exactly are we heading now?
We are going straight south from Sana'a, about 200 kilometer distance, to Da'a city, which is the second biggest city in Yemen. This city was the first city really to run out of water. They are getting the water now every day between 30 and 40 days. They get it for one day or 2 days.
And then I have to wait 30 or 40 more days
To get it again. Yes.
And what do I do in between?
The rest of the time, they have to buy from tankers at a very high cost. We are going to Mount Saber, which is above the city of Taz, and there is an ancient spring, and there there is a conflict between two villages about the spring. Just yesterday there were some killings also.
So they actually got in a gunfight over who controls the spring?
Yeah, fighting. Last time they used even bazookas and heavy machine guns. This is very common, actually. Close to 60% of all rural conflicts, the main cause is water.
Wow.
What part of the country would you describe this as? Are we north? Are we?
It's south of the north.
So central Yemen?
Central Yemen. Central Yemen.
And the village that where the fighting was?
Two villages. One is called Quraba, Q-R-A-D-H.
And the other was?
Al-Marzouh.
Can I see your dagger? That's really cool.
Whoa,
that's a piece of work. I hope it's only used to cut fruit.
It's only decoration.
Gotcha. Let's keep it that way. Is Ahmed one of the official leaders from Marzouh, or is he just a spokesman?
Yeah, he is the sheikh, and
gotcha.
He is the spokesman.
Gotcha.
منذ 13 عام كان نشب الحرب أو المشكلة فيما بيننا وبين الإخوة في قرظة.
13 years ago, this conflict started.
الإخوة في قرظة إخواننا باختصار شديد بغوا علينا. فقاموا بتفجير الخزانات التي عملتها الدولة بما يقارب ب 20 مليون ريال. وفصلوا القصبة التي هي التابعة للمرزوح وضموا الماء كامل إلى قرظة.
كبير يعني ما كان فيش مشكلة في قبل عشرات السنين.
What he's saying is that the people were living for hundreds of years without any conflict. It's only recently because too many people and too little amount of water.
الآن ما عاد في إلا الثلث الآن الماء الموجود الثلث على ما كان قبل سنوات سابقة.
بسبب المطر يعني.
بسبب المطر نعم.
بسبب الأمطار. He's saying that one-third of the spring is still on. Two-thirds is gone.
And many more people. People have big families here?
لكن معي عشرة.
He has 10.
10 kids.
عشرة.
ثمان بنات وولدين.
8 daughters and 2 sons. 10.
Wow. What will happen if your 10 kids have 10 kids?
نعمل سقادة على أرحب الراحم نقول له. الرازق والله.
بعد 10 سنوات 20 سنة يجعل الله تعالى مخرجا.
God will find a solution for us. We cannot say what will happen.
How many people have been hurt in all of this fighting?
كم عدد المصابين الآن؟
الآن عدد المصابين مؤخراً ستة.
هل عندكم؟
أيوة ستة إلى ثمانية.
Six people in the last 2 months.
ابني كان متواجد بعرس تقريباً الساعة 9 بالليل وقعت رصاصة من الجهة مقابلة من المرزوح دخلت بالطاقة بالزجاج صدمت بالعمود وقعت لفوق القلب حقه.
How old was he?
كم عمره؟
22 سنة.
كان عمره 22 years.
أولاً أحس بألم ما قد وصفه الناس ولا كتبوا الكتب ولا أشتي أحد يصاب بهذا المصاب.
Well, this is Hamad Kaid, who is from Quraba. He was hit with 3 bullets maybe 3-4 days ago, and he survived.
قربوا لي الغداء غدي. أزهد على طلقات نار من الطاقة لشق جسمي وناقص طم مكان.
So it's like a sniper.
Sniper, yeah. I know the nas.
All over a fight over what?
هلا كله بسبب الماء. ما فيش حاجة ثانية. سياسة.
أصور. إخوان. ولا بهذا.
There is no politics or anything. All just for the water.
All just for water.
All just for water. That's what he's saying.
So that's just a part of a story, and each of our stories will have, it really starts with impacts of climate change, but also we'll have science, which basically goes into why the impacts are actually a matter of climate change, and politics and solutions. So this is just one chunk of one story. The next one is part of a story where we're following a scientist by the name of M. Sanjin. He's the chief scientist of the Nature Conservancy. And we're following him on this round the world odyssey where he basically checks in with all these different climate scientists around the world, because he came to our office and told us that he'd love to participate in our series, but when it comes to climate change, he's not what you would call a true believer. So we said, okay, what do you mean? And he said, well, I don't really doubt that it's true because there's a scientific consensus, but I won't believe anything unless I've had a chance to study it for myself and see it with my own eyes and make sure that I think it's true. So he said, that's perfect. We're going to take you on a journey where you can meet all the top scientists, ask them all the tough questions, and decide for yourself. And so this is just one little part where he goes with a glaciologist, the head of the Climate Center at the University of Maine, a guy by the name of Paul Majewski. Here you'll see they're in the Andes and they're climbing up to a glacier. This is just one little part of their journey.
Made it up to about 6,500 feet last night, but it did kick my ass a little bit. So today we got an extraordinary long day, probably 8 to 10 hours of hiking. We're gonna go up to about 3,200 meters, so that's over 10,000 feet. And that's where we're gonna have base camp. It's amazing that Paul kind of likes doing this. You know, he really is sort of a bit of an Indiana Jones. It's incredibly rough terrain. You know, when you're on the horses, you just hang on them in the saddles, and you just pray. And there's no sense of controlling these horses. You just hold on, don't look down, and then trust that they'll get up there.
Going out into these extraordinary places, very few people have got into it, been setting up camp, keeping yourself alive while doing really good science is pretty tricky.
You have to learn how to live in these environments. And that's the big difference between the types of things that many of us who work in the field do and others. We know exactly where the data comes from. We can do 100 different measurements on a single little slab of ice. And from that, we can tell all sorts of things. Temperature, precipitation, storm patterns, where the storm came from, industrial pollutants, forest fires, volcanoes, on and on and on.
How far back in time can you go? With confidence?
Year by year, with quite reasonable confidence, we can go back 110,000 years.
Jesus.
Using an ice core that was about 10,000 feet thick that we drilled in Greenland. If you get an ice core from the correct place, you can solve problems. We were able to demonstrate that changes in acid rain were increases were largely due to human activity. And the really exciting thing we were able to demonstrate is that as soon as the legislation came in, which the Clean Air Act, which reduced a lot of those emissions, you see the levels going down. So ice cores don't lie.
Okay, so the next one is from Superstorm Sandy. This is part of a story that begins in Staten Island, which is in a neighborhood called Tottenville, which was one of the most devastated places because by the storm, you know, in addition to places in New Jersey, places in other parts of New York. And who you're gonna see here is our correspondent Chris Hayes from MSNBC, and Michael Grimm, who's a Republican congressman who represents this part of Staten Island, who is basically a climate denier. He doesn't believe that climate change is really happening, or he thinks it's not proven. And then we get Michael Grimm together with a former U.S. congressman named Bob Inglis, who was a very conservative Republican congressman from South Carolina, who in the summer of 2010 said that he believed that climate change was real, that it was happening, and as a result was beaten in the primary. And now he's devoting his life to trying to persuade Republicans that climate change is real and to take action as a result. So that's what you're about to see.
This was the perfect storm. High tide, full moon, everything came together and converged in a way that, and it happened, you know, I heard story after story, and I said to people, why didn't you leave? They said, Congressman, everything was fine. It was a little windy, a little rain. All of a sudden, out of nowhere, I see water coming down the block like a movie. I grabbed my kids and ran as if Godzilla was coming. That type of thing, like all of a sudden, there's the monster.
An entire house would just collapse, and you'd have nothing but a roof on the sidewalk.
On the ground, yeah.
Right, just lying there, the roof, everything else washed away, destroyed. I still didn't get the gravity of that until the rain had stopped and I literally started walking.
Let's see if the Best Western in Bay Ridge has already signed up to accept FEMA. If they haven't, let's get that done and let's see if they have availability. I got someone going to Home Depot now to get as much stuff as we can. Brooms, mops, LED lanterns. Give me 1 minute to help this lady and then I'll speak to you next. We will help you, absolutely. That's what we do. This is what we do. You know, just yesterday they found someone else now. So we're up to 24 people dead. And I hate to say it, but I think there's going to be more.
I think so.
I think there's, you know, in Midland Beach, Newport Beach, Oakwood, I think it's what they call one of those 100-year storms.
The climate overall has changed. But let's leave out the part of whether it's man-made or not, because I don't think the science is there to tell us what's causing it. Mm-hmm. I think Mother Earth evolves, and patterns change every so many 100 years, 1,000 mm-hmm. years, and we're in part of a process of changing. But I don't want to get into the political debate of what's causing it.
I was from maybe the reddest district in the reddest state. 93 American Conservative Union rating, 100% Christian Coalition, 100% National Right to Life, A with the NRA. So pretty conservative guy, right? When I was first in Congress, I totally poo-pooed climate change. I said it was nonsense. Al Gore's imagination. I had a great press conference one time where I absolutely tore Al Gore apart. But then I was out of Congress for 6 years. My kids were growing up. My oldest, who just turned 18 when I was running again in 2004, okay, said, I'll vote for you, Dad, but you're going to clean up your act on the environment. Problem for me was his four sisters agreed and his mother. And so okay, I had this new constituency that could change the locks on the doors.
Yeah, that's
and so
I, the most important constituency.
I had to respond to this constituency, you know. So I So that was part of it for me. And then the other was, I got on science committee when I got back to Congress, went to the South Pole, saw the ice core drillings, saw the evidence. What do you think it is that we Republicans have gotten in this spot of basically distrusting the scientists, you know?
I'm not so sure that it's distrusting the scientist. What Republicans are afraid of is if we give more credence to climate change, that it's going to be, you know, the call, the cry for more rules, more regulations. I would say there's not even a conversation at that point.
Yeah, I agree completely. We're trying to change the conversation. We want to change it away from the apocalyptic visions that rightly signal conservatives that here it comes, a big old wad of regulations and a tax increase. We want to change it to a conversation about reasonable risk avoidance. Borrowing from Tom Friedman, he once told me, he said, you know, 98 doctors tell you to treat your son this way. Two say no this other. It's not conservative to go with two. And that's really sort of where we are in climate science, right? We've got about 98 doctors that say it's for real and it's human caused. And we got two say no, it's not. It's sort of an odd place, I believe, for us as Republicans to be, that we listen to the two. I mean, we actually not even listen. We seek out the two. We call them to hearings. We want to hear from them, the two. Of course, in a way, I'm the worst commercial for this because, you know, I got my head blown off when I said that climate change is real. So in a way, I'm the worst person to try to convince you because, I mean, look what happened to me, right?
Right. The politics, though. You know, look, there's just the reality.
Yeah.
If Republicans start coming out and let's say that they did agree with the science and they were bold enough and had the political courage that you had, if they believed it, to go forward, and then they lose, well, how many other are gonna, they're not all lemmings, okay? Right? They're not gonna just go right off that cliff. So the political constraints, I think, are a lot bigger than most people would understand, yeah. And they're very real.
But you're also in a place that's had a different experience. You've had people that have been inundated with a storm surge that some of them may have this sense of need of addressing a problem. That may give you some room to move that others don't have.
Thanks. The last one is with Tom Friedman, and it's on the border with Syria. We're in Turkey. Tom pretty much described the story, so I don't have to say much.
You say one thing, we were in a Turkish town called Urfa, right across from Raqqa province, which is a heart of drought territory. We're interviewing this woman who is from a town called Deir Ezzur, which is a very important town in northern Syria. She and her son joined the revolution. They lost their farm. He was injured. They came to Turkey for medical care. A couple things just to point out to you. You're going to see pictures of a TV, fighting on TV. One of the things that's happened is Syrian towns now have all developed their own satellite channels. So their apartment, when we come there, they're all watching Deir Ezzur satellite TV, which is covering nonstop the fighting. That's one of the things I think is important to notice.
And the one other thing is, you'll see, just as we were arriving in Turkey on the border, there had been quite a large bombing, actually in Turkey on the Turkish side of the border, not precisely where we were, but
a few miles down the road. The day we arrived, there was a suicide bombing just a few miles down the road, which the Turks blamed on Syrians. Yep. Hit it.
هذا قائد الكتيبة. هاي مجموعتنا. هذا أخوي فراس. هذا ما هذا استشهد. هاي احنا على الدبابة.
كان عندنا أراضي زراعية. كانت في يعني الأمطار كانت حيل زينة يعني. كانت أمطار سنوية حيل زينة تمطر علينا بمطر بهاي. كانت الأراضي حيل مروية. بعدين فجأة صار فيها الجفاف هذا. أرض قحلة صارت ملحة. يعني شوفي يعني ايش قد ما اوصف لك ما راح تنوصف على هالشيء هذا اللي شفناه.
كل وحده يعني واحد اخذهم واعتقلوها وحطوها بالسجن يعني شيء صعب. ضلينا الا طلعنا.
Had you ever seen anything like that before?
لا هاي اول مره يمر علينا هالجفاف هذا. يعني ما يعني انا الي سنين يعني نزرع وهاي بحياتي ما مر علينا هالجفاف. هاي اول مره يصير عندنا هالجفاف هذا. أول مرة إحنا كنا قاعدين بالدوام وعم نحكي إنه في قحل وفي جفاف لازم العالم لازم الحكومة تساعد بس ما حدا عم يستجيب. بالعكس أجوا أخذونا على التحقيق وعلى الأساس يوم والثاني وبالأخير اعتقلونا لمدة شهرين.
Two months they took you away for 2 months.
إيه اعتقلونا لمدة شهرين وبعدين طلعنا على الأساس إنه ما حد يحكي نهائيا. مع أول صيحة الله أكبر إحنا كلياتنا قمنا للثورة مباشرة.
You don't look like a revolutionary. Who joined first? Did you lead Muhammad or did Muhammad lead you?
فأول شيء أنا وهو يقول لي لا هو بعدين أنا يعني اثنيناتنا سوا إن شاء الله سوا. كثير بعدين أنا كنت مرابطة يعني من المرابطين بالثورة. والله شايلة العدة تبعي وأركض معهم يعني من حارة لحارة ومن قرنة لقرنة في سبيل إني أسعف المرضانين والجرحى اللي ينصابوا بالحرب. بس من انصاب ابني محمد أخذته وطلعت فيه على لهون على تركيا.
صواب ببطنه وبرجلي لا قدروا يسقفوني. بعدها هربوني بعد مدينة الميادين بعد عملوا لي 3 عمليات. بعدين جابوني لهون عملوا لي عملية الأخيرة برجلي.
And what are your plans now? You want to go back and rejoin your comrades and continue the revolution?
أكيد راجع كمل ما الشيء اللي مشينا عليه بالأول الشيء اللي حلفنا عليه من الأول.
The only way you operate here is to compartmentalize. If you took it all in and thought about it, you'd be paralyzed. Well, I got emails from friends back home saying, I hope you were nowhere near that bomb. And my answer was, no, it was in the village next door. And so for me, it could have been in Greenland. You know, I mean, you just learn in this part of the world, not on your street, not in your town, not in your village, march on. What's going on? On the other side of that border right now, what is it like?
Now it's somehow more risky after the clashes. The closest fighting is here, 35 kilometers south.
Where are we right now?
We are here now. I think you can get a permission to pass from Akçakarı.
Secondary aim, I classify it as the secondary aim, is your job.
The secondary aim.
That's the secondary aim. The primary aim is that everybody goes home in exactly the same condition that we're all sitting here now. It's the most dangerous place for journalists in the world at the moment. Nobody really knows we're coming. Is that correct?
Yeah.
We're going to do about 10 minutes. Tune in next week, as we say. So that's what we've been up to, and we've got about 10 minutes or so for questions if you have about either the story or the production. There's roving mics, and the floor is open. If anybody has a question. Over here, we've got one. Oh, and one back there. We'll get to everybody. Pass the mic down.
Thank you. Greg Hammer from Everblue. I do sustainability training. This is amazing. A new big step for you as a change agent, my friend. Do we have to wait for Showtime, or can we buy a DVD?
Thank you. Bless
your
heart.
That's the question. How do I get this fast?
You know, we'll have a very robust social media campaign that's going to be ramped. It's already ramping up a little bit, but within the next few months, there'll be a lot of stuff going online. We can't actually put these exact stories online without violating our contract with Showtime, but we will be putting lots of other stuff online, a lot of behind the scenes material and lots of video, lots of text.
Thanks so much.
Appreciate
it. Over here, and then we'll come back up here.
Nancy Zirkin, I'm blown away by this. I think everybody here is. It's amazing. My question is, Obama has finally said that we are going to give aid and help. Is it going to help? Is it going to work? What do you think, Tom?
Well, it's a really complicated question. We could probably do a whole hour on that. You know, the dilemma, I think, of Syria right now is that doing nothing probably guarantees that almost certainly guarantees more bad things will happen. But doing something doesn't guarantee good things will happen. And that's the definition of a problem from hell. And so I have a lot of sympathy for the president in this dilemma. And so I, rather than give you maybe a specific answer, which I don't have, and the problem humbles me, I'll tell you that. Let me try to put it in context for you, the way I see it. I think what we're dealing with right now we're finally dealing with the implications of the end of the Ottoman Empire, okay? It may sound funny, but that's exactly what we're dealing with. For 500 years, we had the Ottoman Empire really controlled this region and had a way of managing all the pluralism, all the different sects, ethnic groups, and religions. And the contest for power was, relatively speaking, taken back to Istanbul. The World War I ends with the collapse of the Ottoman Empire. The British and French come in, and they rule the region. They control this incredibly rich multiplicity of populations, and they carve it up into states that in no way correspond in any way to the ethnic groups within them. So we go from the Ottoman Empire ruling this region vertically, from the top down with an iron fist, to British and French colonial powers ruling the region vertically, top down with an iron fist. The British and French then leave after World War II, and they turn it over to kings, and the kings give way to colonels and generals and various dictators who continue to rule the region vertically from the top down with iron fists. Now there's no more Ottoman Empire. There's no more British and French, and there are no more iron-fisted dictators. So there's only one way this region can be governed, and that is horizontally, by the constituent elements of these states, the constituent communities coming together and building social contracts for how to live together. What you're seeing play out is a whole region going from vertical to horizontal. A region that is pluralistic, but has no tradition of pluralism in the political sense. And that's the struggle that's playing out. One thing I learned in Yemen, though, Yemen's actually having the best Arab Spring, if one can speak of that. And it's very important to understand why. Yemen's having the best Arab Spring because Ali Abdullah Saleh, the president, who was deposed, was ousted from power, but not ousted from politics. So he lost his leadership, but he and his whole constituency are part of a national dialogue that's been going on for 6 months that will lay the basis for a new social contract. I learned something living in Beirut from 1979, roughly on and off, to 1984, 5 years. So we were there years 4 through 9 of the Lebanese Civil War. The Lebanese Civil War ended for one reason at Taif in year 14, on one principle: no victor, no vanquished. Everyone's got to learn to live together. And the minority group, the Christians, were actually overrepresented. They're 35% of the population, but got 50% of the seats in parliament. Today, we have massive demonstrations on the streets of Cairo. Get rid of the Muslim Brotherhood. There's only one way any of these revolutions are going to get sorted out, and that is on the principle of no victor, no vanquished. If anyone thinks Egypt's going to be fine because the army comes in and now throws out the Muslim Brotherhood and brings back the secular and nationalist groups, the only way it's going to be ended is with no victor, no vanquished. The problem now is there's no more empires. I'm not advocating empires. I'm saying to keep order. There's no midwife, no third party to come in, and there's no Mandela, no internal leader pulling people together. When you have no midwife and no Mandela, you have civil war. That's my short analysis of what's going on. Right up here. Yeah, right up here. They'll get the mic. Yeah.
I understand why the climate change deniers have currency in denying it because of the sense of responsibility to whomever they're responsible to avoid regulations, et cetera. What I don't understand is how the masses buy into that, how that's permitted the people that are in New Jersey and South Carolina and different places where they're having these issues, they see it firsthand. And the other thing I'd like to just for you to comment on is what part of U.S. policy impacts the water struggle that's going on between the two villages in the spring?
Well, you know, I simply say on climate, and Sol, you alluded to this, you know, even at a great show like 60 Minutes, they have to pretend that there's a debate. So if you have a climate scientist on, you have to have an opponent on.
And
I mean, it's like, it'd be like having, you know, Newton on, and then a guy who thinks the apple actually jumped from the ground into the tree, you know. That's really what we're doing, but.
You know, there's a.
something that came from the tree down, something that came up the end of the tree.
Right. What did President Obama call them, the flat earthers?
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
I mean, I take a little offense at that, but it's
you know, there's a whole web of climate denial, and some of the scientists who are involved in casting doubt on climate change, you know, the 2 out of the 100 that Bob Inglis talked about, are the same people who are casting doubt on whether tobacco caused cancer, and, you know, whether, you know, acid rain was harmful for the environment, and on, and whether, you know, aerosols depleted the ozone layer. And so
they're merchants of doubt. They're the business of creating doubt. They don't have to defeat you.
Yeah.
They don't have to prove their case. They just have to create doubt, and that's what paralyzes it.
And you know, and unfortunately, they have, I think, even more currency because they're allied with a status quo of, you know, an entire fossil fuel industry, which stands to lose as a result of climate change mitigation. You know, so they're you know, which history has shown has actually funded a lot of these merchants of doubt. And they've been very successful. A lot of people have doubt in their minds about something on which there's really no doubt. You know, it's definitely there. 98% of scientists, you know, can see that it's scientifically.
The problem with climate change is you'll only know for sure when it's way too late. Yeah. That's the dice we're throwing. We actually, on our way to the Middle East, we stopped in Oxford and interviewed
Miles Allen.
Miles Allen, one of the great climate scientists, and he came to our interview with some loaded dice. And actually, the film where I start with him shaking the dice, and it always comes up 6, because what he says is we're just loading the dice here, you know, and it's more and more often, you know, going to come up with bad news. Let's get another question. Thanks.
Hi, thank you for your documentary. It really touched me deeply because I come from China, and there is also very bad water shortage there. And I'm just wondering, first, do you plan to do any writing or documentation about that problem in that part of the world? Second, I want to ask, do you see any parallel between what happened in the Middle East to what is happening now in China today?
Well, I mean, definitely.
Are we doing anything in China?
Well, the sad fact is that we don't have a China story in the first season of our series. We have 18 different stories, and we just didn't get there. I mean, we're in Indonesia, we're in Bangladesh, we're in the Middle East, we're in Greenland, we're in South America. But for season two, we'll definitely go to China, we'll definitely go to India. And I think, you know, the phenomenon of a water shortage and climate change is something that's happening throughout the globe. It's the Middle East in particular, and the Sahel is getting hotter and drier, which is, you know, basically what both of those stories were about in Yemen and Syria. There's glacial melt. Everywhere the glaciers supply, people with their drinking water, they're running into water crises because the glaciers are disappearing. So,
The Arab Spring was it was triggered by many things, stressed by the climate, but it really comes down to one word, and that's dignity, you know. And governments that don't respect their people, on a world where every leader in the world is now in a two-way conversation. There's no more one-way conversation, not in a world of Weibo, not in a world of blogging and Twitter and Facebook. On my way home from Cairo, I stopped in Istanbul and was there for the climax of the eviction of the protesters from Taksim Square. And that was if I were leaders in China, I would be really studying what happened there, because it was very interesting. A group of Turkish environmentalists started with wanting to protect one of the last green spaces in Istanbul, Gezi Park in Taksim Square, from a plan by Erdogan to build a huge Ottoman museum there and to pave it over and create a mall and a shopping center. People immediately joined in. Why did they join in? Because basically, Erdogan had for 11 years, although enormously economically successful, had infantilized his people. Was telling women, whether they should have a cesarean section or not, how many children they should have. Completely crushed the Turkish media to the point when the Turkish rebellion, call it what you will, began. CNN Turk, the main news channel, did not cover it. They showed a film about penguins, and NTV, the other main Turkish channel, showed a film on cooking risotto. So what did the protesters do? They said, oh, no, excuse me. Those are your channels? Well, we have our own channel now. It's called Twitter. The official opposition, which had completely been neutered, they said, oh, we don't need them anymore. We have our own parliament. It's called Taksim Square. So in 36 hours, they created an alternative command and control system to both organize and get their message out, and an alternative national opposition. That happened in 36 hours. I'd be worried about that if I were a CEO, let alone the president of China. We have time for one more. Back there, yeah.
Thank you so much. It's quite inspiring. I had a quick question regarding the macro trends that are going on with water scarcity. Coca-Cola and Pepsi are distributed in most of the places of the world, and yet we have a very difficult time getting water there. Do you see a future in the next 5 to 10 years of more of these conflicts resulting from just the simple water trade? And how do we solve or take steps to solve that? Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know about the commercial side of it, but certainly when you look at Yemen, you see that the future will be conflict over water. Yemen's only hope is desalination. Desalination is enormously expensive, and they'd have to pump it up from the Gulf Coast all the way to Sana'a. It's all uphill. And so this is a really poor country. As Abdurrahman al-Yani says, 80% of the conflicts there today are over water. And it's really superseding really all the other political issues. We have time for one more quick one up here. Yeah. Up here in the front row. If you just shout out your question, we'll give it. You got the microphone? Thanks. And then we'll close with that.
My question is whether you are optimistic that initiatives like the Years Project and one similar to it will effectively create the political will to demand U.S. climate leadership.
Well, you know, I'll give my answer and then I'm going to let Saul close because he wouldn't be doing this if he weren't an optimist to some degree. I really live by the motto of Dana Meadows, who was a great environmental teacher at Dartmouth, late Dana Meadows. And she used to be asked about climate change, isn't it too late? Or is it too late? And she'd say, no, it's not too late. But we have exactly enough time starting now. And that was really my message to all the Arab environmentalists we met with. You guys have exactly enough time starting now. You do not have time to engage in a debate over who is the proper heir to the Prophet Muhammad from the 7th century, the Sunni or Shiite clan. You do not have time to debate which tribe is going to rule this well in ties or that well in ties. You've got to shift to thinking about the commons, and you have exactly enough time starting now. Solly?
I'll just say, you know, we just came from a talk by Hal Harvey, who's this amazing climate change expert, who's a scientist. And, you know, in terms of the science and the technological fixes, he's somewhat optimistic, so that makes me somewhat optimistic. But on the side of sort of public opinion and media, you know, look what happened with marriage equality. I mean, in the space of less than a decade, basically the numbers just completely reversed themselves. And now it's the law of the land that, you know, men can marry men and women can marry women, and it's legal. So I don't see why, you know, I have a lot of hope, actually, especially when I talk to young people, that there's a shift going on and we're heading back to
give you your clothes.
The place where, you know, a series like ours might be able to do some good.
And?
Yeah.
And?
Oh, well, I mentioned it already. Anyone who wants to get involved, anybody who wants to help support us, you know, we do need some more support in order to finish episodes 7 and 8 and fund our social media campaign. So, you know, don't be shy. I have lots of cards in my back
pocket.
Thanks
for coming. Appreciate
it. Thank you.